Welcome in this afternoon session. My talk will be over Linux disaster recovery as a service. So, welcome. My name is Gracian Daas. I'm one of the maintainers of the Relax and Recover program. But this talk will begin with a broad perspective talking about disaster recovery and disaster recovery planning, etc., etc. But let's start with it. Okay. The agenda. So the question sometimes is, do disasters really happen? Well, we'll soon know why. We'll talk about planning, about the software that is available on the market, how to do it in practice, how to exercise it. Then I will discuss in particular the open source project Relax and Recover. It's one of the open source projects that are related to disaster recovery. And as last topic, I want to spend some time describing what a disaster recovery as a service could mean, how to build it up from ground. Okay, the question is, do disasters really happen? These are pictures from disasters that are only less than 1 year old. And fire can happen. This year we had a lot of snowfall, roofs collapsed. So this is a picture from Belgium somewhere. You can have a flood, water breakage, computer rooms can go underwater, etc., etc. Earthquakes is maybe less important in Belgium, but you never know, of course. But seriously, the most critical disaster that can happen is a burnout of your computer, hard disk that fails. You could protect by a good fan. Well, it's a silly picture, but okay, it's to bring some joy in the talk. So to give you some small basics, if we talk about disaster recovery, and the disaster recovery is in fact a small piece of a complete disaster. And disaster recovery is about how to restore a function, for example, a computer, to a ready state again, so it is working as before. In contrary, you have also business continuity. That's the process of the business. How will the business react when a disaster happens until that business is restored as usual, as normally? So that's a complete different broad spectrum about disaster recovery, restoration, in fact. In this talk, I will concentrate on the first part, disaster recovery of computer, data centers, etc. Albeit the second part will be a very interesting talk, but that will be for another time, I believe. So, disaster recovery. The question is always, will it happen? Yes, of course. Probably most of the people here in the room already had a disaster, more or less. Computer breaks. You lose your computer, for example. You lose important data. These things happen. Unfortunately, we are not always prepared. So, the important lesson, if you go out here, is be prepared and react timely on a disaster. So, before you can react timely, you need a plan. That's very important. So, don't hesitate. If you have a disaster, you have to know what to do immediately. So, I got often the question, I have a good backup server, good backup policy. Excellent. You have to have that, because it's very important to restore data. But in case of a disaster, backups are not always enough. Because you can restore your data, of course, but if you lose your computer, you have to restore your computer. New hard disk, for example. You have to reload your OS. You have to fine-tune it, reinstall your backup software. That takes a lot of time. And in case of disaster, you don't have that much of a time because you can lose so much time, days, sometimes weeks. I even had it very long time ago that even after months, a lot of tweaks came up because they were from a disaster, because nobody knew how it was configured in, after months anymore. So it's very important to foresee these kind of things. And it can help you with a kind of inventory of your hardware and software. It's very important to have it. There's software available. I will speak about it a bit later. So the plan, disaster recovery plan. I will stress the word plan. That's very important. Before a disaster, you can act on the disaster, you need to plan everything. You have to find the money. You have to convince your managers of a decent plan. You have to exercise a plan, so you need to have extra hardware available, or you hire it. It depends on the amount of value you get from the managers. And it will guarantee that you, if you exercise it, that you know what to do, that you can act immediately. That's very important. And the last line, that's very low, you can see it, is the less managers around you, in case of disaster, the better. Because they always tend to influence you, to run in your way. It's very important. Decision makers, get them out. And with a decent plan, that's the way to do it. Very important. So what are the main steps in a disaster recovery plan? Well, the risk analysis. Before you can act on a plan, you have to know what can happen and what are the factors in my computer room, which are important, because not all the operating systems, not all the data, not all the computers, assets or functions of computers are equally important. So you have to make some categories which computers should be restored immediately. Like, for example, a database server is most of the times one of the important things to restore immediately when a disaster happens or you exercise a disaster. It's very important. You have to develop a plan, of course. You have to time it. You have to write it down. You have to make an inventory. And therefore, you have to go around in your computer room. You have to know the labelings. The operators have to be trained and stuff like that. So there are a lot of checklists to be made and a lot of meetings to be done with a lot of people. But the important point is you have to convince your managers, your directors, your board of directors that you need a budget. A large budget, hopefully, to give you the time to exercise everything. Because it takes a lot of time to make a decent inventory and to test it, stuff like that. And very important is also the last line here, you have to test the disaster recovery plan. Because once you made it, that's not enough. Because your computer room is continuously alive and changing. So there are new computers going out, others going out, and new functions coming, so you have to redo the exercise or the thinking about the planning at least at the yearly basis. Also the testing, very important. To do it, not all the computers, but one in a time, for example, you could do categorize it and just test it. Of course, it's always better to prepare a disaster to avoid the effect. So keep it simple and stupid. Some simple things is having good mirroring, good backup, of course. Test your restores of backups, very important. And to make an inventory, this in the open source world, a very good program available. It's called Configure2HTML. That makes a kind of hardware inventory of your system, but also a software inventory, and keeps a listing of all your configurations effect. And you can put it aside. And of course, when you are ready to start with that, you have to find a good, decent program to do the bare metal restores. There are quite a bunch available. I give you some overview of what is available now. The first choice is, do we go for commercial or open source? Yeah, I know. Here we are all convinced that open source is the way to go, me too. And luckily, there are a lot of big companies, huge companies, that are realizing that open source is not bad. I remember 20 years ago it was a disaster to convince the managers that open source was better than closed source. But the mindset is changing in a good way, that open source does get a chance also in the disaster recovery environments. That's a good point. But anyway, whatever you choose, if it's commercial or open source, you have to test it. But because not every program does fit your needs, or maybe you don't like it anyway. So the testing is very important. Never test on a production server, of course. Always a test server. So what are the solutions available in the open source world? Commercial, I don't talk about. You have a lot of categories in the open source world. You have disaster recovery modules that are available in, for example, a backup solution. To name one is Bacala. It's an open source backup solution. It's a very good open source backup solution. But I'm not too fond of having a disaster recovery module that you get as an extra thing with a backup, because the main focus is on backup. And you can only be good at one point, backup or disaster recovery. So you are very linked to Bakelite itself, and that's not always the best opportunity. But okay, if you like it, fine. Another possibility is the cloning. Cloning is nice to make new systems, but it's not the right way to do a disaster recovery, because it's a snapshot, it's always old, and it doesn't give you the flexibility that you need sometimes on new, a little bit different hardware. That's the problem with cloning system. Now, it's not always 100% alike, and then it doesn't work. I had it already a few times, but it's okay. It's good for one purpose, but not for disaster recovery, in my opinion. But okay, you don't have to believe me, of course. Test it yourself. And then you have the true open source disaster recovery software. Their main focus is on disaster recovery, luckily, and not on backup. But okay, you can do backups with it, but it's not really a backup solution. It's a disaster recovery solution that gives you also backups. But okay. And their main focus is to give you a very quick environment, user interface, not a very fancy user interface. That's not important. When you are in disaster recovery mode, you have only a laptop or a small terminal, sometimes only a prompt. So what the heck are you with a fancy user interface in that moment? You need command lines. You need to type something very fast, and it has to act immediately. Okay, in this category, we have three open source disaster recovery software available in the market. We have Mondo Rescue, that's about from 2000. We have MKCDREC, makes CD-ROM recovery, and we have Relax and Recover. I can only say something about MKCDREC because I wrote it also. So it's also my piece of software, which is the predecessor of Relax and Recover. It's a wonderful, wonderful program, but it's so monolithic. It's not flexible enough to react on chains, and you need chains also in disaster recovery models. Therefore, we rewrote, in fact, MKCDREC in a new program, Relax and Recovery. So MKCDREC is still existing, and the user base is still very huge. I try to convince people to go to Relax and Recover, but sometimes it's difficult because they like it so much. Okay. You have Mondo Rescue. That's also a good program, but okay, I won't talk about it because I never use it much. So, okay, in disaster recovery, the medium or the data is very important. Never store your data of your disaster recovery on your local computer. Always use external data storage. Very important. Whatever the bootable medium is, it's not that important. You have to boot your new system via an ISO image, a CD or whatever, or via the network, Pixie booting, via USB, via a tape with one button disaster recovery. Everything is possible. And you can mix the two things. You have a boot medium and you have your data storage where your backups are stored on. It can be on the same media, it can be different. You can have a LAN-only solution that you boot from a central boot server, Pixie server, and that in fact your archivals or your data storage is in fact on an S server, on different system, perfectly possible. Or in a different environment, where you don't have a fancy NAS server, you can have it on a tape, an external tape drive, you can boot from the tape, you can have it on a USB disk. These days the USB can be a total solution, you can boot from the USB and you have the data also on it, because in USB you can remove and store it in a vault somewhere, whatever. There are different solutions, even TAR or rsync is possible, you can do it over the network, for example, a firewall. You don't have a lot of rules. You only need the secure shell rsync rule, in fact, to go through your internal data center. It's all possible, but you have to configure it, of course. How does disaster recovery work in practice? First of all, you have to gather the system information. So the program that you use will collect all your data, network information, boot information, your disk information, all kinds of information has to be gathered. It has to be stored on a central place. Also the disk layout, LVM, RAID stuff, if you're using RIP, LILO or iLILO for Itanium-based systems. you have to make a system backup from that particular time, and also the user data, but not necessarily. And you have to make a bootable image, in fact, because in the case of disaster recovery, you have to boot from that image that you created. That image can be stored on a CD, on a network, tape, USB, whatever. And all these steps are done online. That's a very nice thing of it. So you can have a production server, you can just launch it via CRAN or another queuing system, daily, weekly, whatever, and you have it online available. That is the practice for making the rescue image. Now, if you are in a disaster recovery mode, you need that rescue image to boot from. So you boot your system, and you have a toolbox. Okay, and here I'm describing that for the rescue image, you need also the Linux kernels and the device drivers, the network configuration, stuff like that. But okay, and it's all done in RAM, so the initRD environment. Now we come to the recovery phase. In the recovery phase, you need to boot from the rescue image. You have to restore your disks layout. First of all, you have to recreate your partitions, the file systems that were originally created. You have to mount it. And then, once mounted, you have to restore the data from your data store, whatever it was. When that is done, you restore the bootloaders, and in fact, that's it. Once the bootloaders are there, you can do a manual inspection or not, depends, and you can just reboot your system, and that's finished. That's in fact the simple steps in disaster recovery, making an image and then restoring the image back on the new hardware or a new virtual partition, doesn't matter, and just boot it, and it should work. Let's talk a little bit about Relax and Recover. Relax and Recover was created in 2006 together with my colleague, it's a German colleague, Shlomo Shapiro. He was a very fan of MKC Direct, and we decided together to rewrite it from scratch. He also has some open source projects, and together we rewrote it, in fact, in 2 months' time or so. We have the first release available. So it was an incredible solution, and the way it was, because it was completely written in a modular way. But I come back to that later. Relax and Recover has come from a far way, from 2006, where we have no users effect, until now that we have a very broad user environment, going from big companies, even in Belgium. Don't know if Jeroen and Dag are available.
No, he's not here,
he's sick. He's here sick, okay. Because we can say that the federal police is going the open source way and they use Relax and Recovery for the disaster recovery feature. So, thank you, nice. Federal police. But not only the federal police is using it, the German government, a lot of German governments are using it, and also quite a lot of commercial companies, even very big ones, that are using it for the global disaster recovery policy. And important is, it's available since beginning last year in Fedora, so you can just do yum install, rear. And also it is shipping with SLES 11, SP2, SP3. It is in the image over there. And it integrates, which is very important, we find that very important, as a modular system, you can integrate very easily external backup software. So there are already a few external backup software linked into rear, so that your backup is in fact stored with, for example, Tivoli or Data Protector of Net Backup. Bacala is also available. So you don't care about rear with your backup. It's done by the really good backup software that you trust, because the companies that trust their backup software, because the operators are trained for it. So it's a very good selling point that your disaster recovery system integrates very well with your existing backup software. But of course, we are in an open source environment, and we, first of all, we delivered GNU/TAR as the main default backup solution. rsync is another possibility, and now we have, since the new release 1.9, Bacala also as an open source solution. And it scales very well, that already told you that. Okay, a bit of history, I just mentioned already. It is in fact a spin-off of two open source projects. and it was released, and it was even in 3 weeks' time, not 1 month or 2 months. Okay, what are the features? Relaxer recovery, or RIR, which I will mention RIR in the future, is focused on disaster recovery only. Backup is not, well, backup is important, but not the main focus. So we are not really interested in doing, in, let's say, incremental backups. We try to do a complete full backup as the main integration. So it's in fact a simple full backup integration. It complements also the backup software, of course, because backup is very good in incrementals and give you a long time data storage, but backup software is not really intended to do disaster recovery. So the two software pieces, they fit together very well. And that, in fact, is what we try to propose, or what is our methodology, is say, use the best tool for the job. So I already mentioned that external backup software or commercial backup software is supported and included today. Even last week we had a new release, 1.9. We are very excited with it because there are a lot of bug fixes solved, and also a lot of new features were added. But I will talk about that a bit later. So the integration is very transparent, and other backup solutions are still available and still are missing. But for commercial backup solutions, we are working with a sponsoring model. So we don't write it just for the fun. We can add it if you'd like to pay for this. And very important, in my opinion, that RIR is integrating very well in the network. So you can have a complete network-only solution. You don't have to fiddle with tapes or with CDs or with other external hardware. You can do it, but you don't have to do it. And that's the fundamental important point if you want to make a service around it. You have to make a service, you need a good network. Not everyone has a good network, but okay. For the big companies who can afford it, they do have it. A good network also means a good SAN solution, so that NAS or SAN is available, so you can have a very quick storage or retrieval from your storage from your environment. What is also important, that the companies, if we deliver the software, it's open source of course, but they can make their own branded RPMs or packages for them, but it doesn't matter. So they can tweak it a little bit and they can repackage it and just distribute it to all their computers. I think that's an advantage, and the scheduling, of course, that's done by their scheduling team or whatever. So the development of RIR is an open source based model, and we're using SourceForge to store our data, and you can use Subversion to get the snapshots available, but the snapshots are also available on the internet. You can have a daily update of our builds. Development is done based on sponsoring or also done by the community. We have some, well, I already told you we have two main developers, but there are quite some active developers in the community. Two guys from the Federal Police, for example, they are very active the last months and working very close to us, with us, to make new features available, which I'm very grateful. And that's the strong point of open source, it is. You have a community, and the community, you can feedback, you get feedback from the community, and you get very good ideas. And together with it, you can have a discussion, and you can work to a good solution, because sometimes we get patches, and we are very grateful that we get patches, but there's sometimes very weak. And then we have the community, and we can improve the patches very quickly. And that is very nice. I like it very much, that framework. Why is that framework so important? Because RIR was built with, in the back of our heads, we knew about the faults we made with MKC Direct. It was very monolithic. It was a very strong program, and still very strong. It's so monolithic that only I were able, in fact, to do a very good code design, code development, code patching. That's not very good module effect. The model that we now have is a framework. You can just plug in modules, And it's a very easy module because it's written in Bass. We don't have C coding, not yet so far. It's just a Bass script, very small, sometimes only 10 lines long that do a job. So it's easy to debug and you can just plug it in. I explain it a bit later. Documentation is online. I just released 1.9 of Rear and also the release notes. And the presentation will also be on our website, so you can then download it from the presentation section. I will do it this evening. Okay. So the architecture of Rear, I explained it's a modular way. So if you do a command Rear dump, you will get an overview like on the left side, not the pictures, of course. That gives you what architecture are you running on, what is the OS vendor, which version of the vendor you're using, and you have a configuration tree. On the left side, you see the configs which are available. Most of the configs are a bit made by us and best practice, but there are two configuration files that are very interesting for you. It's called the site.conf and the local.conf. The site.conf effect is there you can put some variables for your site. For example, for your company, these are important. If you are working to the same Pixel server, you can define it over there. For your local computer, you can just use the local.conf. And these are stored in the /etc/rear directory. So how do you use it? All the scripts are stored under the user share rear subdirectories. There you find the complete directory structure. And we have a list of methods. A method to make and rescue image, a method to restore it. So it's the same data. Your rear executables, well, scripts, are also on the rescue image. And also the configuration files. So each configuration file that you modify on a local computer is also on the rescue image. So it's copied effect. So you have the exact same definitions and the exact same programs available. And you can make backup, or make backup only is available, and the recover, important if you want to restore. And also you can plug in modules, like I said. For example, the config to HTML is already available, not as a model, but if you install, for example, config to HTML, you can just enable it in Rear with a variable, and then it will automatically detect it and run it and store the output of config to HTML in the subdirectories of /var/lib Rear effect. Okay, already explained the site and the local configuration files. You can see some examples. An example, output. Output could be an ISO, could be a tape, could be one better disaster recovery, for example. You have also backup definitions, NetFS. NetFS is, for example, with an S server, NFS server, SIF server. Also, USB is a NetFS solution. And we tend to use a lot of the NetFS solution. And the NetFS goes together with the NetFS URL. And there are some other options. If you need, for example, user password credentials, you can have some options over there. These options, you don't have to know it by heart, of course. It's all described in a concept guide. You can find it on the website. And we also have a new file in the documentation directory or subdirectory, which gives you an overview of the possible configurations that you can have to start with, because I know it's a bit confusing in the beginning, but that is fact, it's very easy. Once you understand how it works, it's very simple. This is a simple output of the Rear command. If you don't type any option, it will give you some help and a list of commands which are available to type. Always handy to start with is the dump command, which you saw in a few slides before, that gives you an overview of which is your current OS. And then the second option that you can start with is make rescue, of course, that makes a rescue image without backup. If you say just make rescue, it makes a disaster recovery image, you can boot from it. So it's handy, you need to test it. You need to know if my image boots on my system or another system. So before you do a make backup and recover. But okay, Don't worry, there are a few papers already on the internet that explaining the commands and how to use it in different scenarios. The backup or rescue method, that's almost the same. There's only one difference, that make backup makes also a backup and the rescue not. For the rest it's exactly the same. It has some phases. Phases, I already discussed a bit in the disaster recovery analyzing. You have a preparation phase, you analyze your system, and it's all stored under the VARLIP rear recovery subdirectory. So there you find your data on your local system. That directory is also copied on the rescue image. So you can always look at your local system to see what the latest status is of your configuration files. And there's different phases. It's not that important that I explain it, but you can find it in the constant guide, a more detailed explanation of it. An example, if you use the flag minus S, it's a simulation. It's very interesting. It gives you an overview of all little subscripts which are included in a certain method or phase. Well, it's not readable, but okay, if you install it and just try it once, it doesn't harm anything. It doesn't do anything at all. It just shows you which commands or which commands methods affect and which scripts will be executed in which order. The order is also very important. So from the left to the right. And you have a log file. The log file is stored under the /tmp. It's called rear-hostname.log. Very interesting to look at. Not much output is given, but it's very good if you have errors, you will see them there. The recovery phase is, well, it's the opposite. You have the recovery system. These are the steps that are required, is the verification. It will verify if your rescue image is capable of doing a recovery. If you only did a make rescue and don't have backup, and the method says, for example, Bacala, but you didn't define any Bacala environment, yeah, of course, nothing can be restored, and it will complain about it. Okay. Very important to know is, if you decide a method to use, for example, a backup and an output, the recover phase will use exactly the same one. Because I explained that the make rescue, make backup, and the recover are using the same set of configuration files. So don't expect to do something else. It's important to know. Or you have to foresee it. Nothing is impossible, but that's part of the planning. Also here you can do a minus S. You see that here it is a very small output because it was a request restore. That is a very simple method that will just do its job and then wait and tell you I'm ready for the restoration. And then you have to do an other kind of thing to restore your data. For example, an rsync or something else. And then it waits for you. And when you're done, you just click return. And it does it, the rest of its job. The making bootloader active, for example. That's a very stupid way of doing disaster recovery. But it is available. In some cases, it could be interesting. Already explained the config to HTML. Cannot stress enough, it's quite important. If you activate it, you will see a line coming up, the red line over there. And you will have some extra lines or text files available under the subdirectory var lib rear recovery config to HTML. Very handy in case of disaster. What hardware did I had? What operating systems were operating systems? Which configuration files are available? How are the settings? Etc. Etc. Again, the log file. That's an example. What is the status? The status, I already explained it, is very mature on Intel and 46-based architecture. It's also working on Itanium and PowerPC, but it's less tested. So it is working, but well, the more users will using it, more feedback we will get, of course. It is released as an RPM TAR in depth, and it ships with OpenSUSE and Fedora. And well, support is available via SourceForge, and we are open for patch submissions, of course. The more, the better. The current development, already mentioned, 1.9 has just been released, and it is the basic steps for starting with cloning. It's still in beta. It does work, but you cannot rely 100% on it because we still need to tune things. So in the next release, it will be much better. But it is already usable for migration from physical to virtual, vice versa, whatever. And that worked quite well. The one button disaster recovery method is available. Don't think much people using it still, but okay, it's there. And what my point is, the DHCP client is available, and you need that infrastructure for having a server service afterwards. So the network again. And there's a toolkit available for doing other stuff than just recovery, but to do some inspection of your system. What is still missing is a central point of storage. I already had, we had the central point of storage of your data via NAS server. What is still missing is a central point of your rescue images, for example, or your configuration files. Because it's, you do it locally, you put it on USB or on the tape or CD, and you, or you copy it manually to a central point. These kind of things could be automated. And that is, in fact, what we are working now as a future step. It's called disaster recovery as a service. Collect also the rescue images, configuration files to a central point so that we get a service around it. And that point software we will call Rio Server. So in the first phase, in fact, we are collecting the information and making a web-based interface around it so that you can just make a listing of servers that you did in disaster recovery. Did it work? What were the failures? You can look at the log files, for example. You can restart it. These kind of actions should be possible in the first phase. You can group it by department, by host, OS, stuff like that. That will be the planning for the coming months. And the plans are now, after 6 months predicting in, getting very real. So you may expect that within the 6 months, the first release of Rio Server will be released. What are the requirements? It should go, for example, through a firewall, other boundaries, network boundaries. It should be protocol independent, so we don't want to have fancy protocols used. We only want to use the standard available protocols on the systems, so we don't want to install too much other stuff, except the rear server, perhaps. But even the rear server on the side of the client shouldn't be any additional software. Should be just a new rear version, in fact. The rear server is only on the central part. Maybe a few changes are required in the rear software, new variables. You have to point to a rear server. The sent results, how do you want the data to be sent via mail or via HTTP, for example, and some other small things, and maybe a bit of bunch of scripts to plug in the right spot. The Rio Server architecture could be like this. It's not 100% defined. We are still open for discussion, and discussions are ongoing on the mailing list, on developers' mailing list of Rio. So if you like it, just subscribe yourself to the Rio mailing list of development, and you can have a live discussion with us. How do you want to see it? What is the best approach? Because we have our own ideas, and we already know from the past our ideas are maybe not always the best ideas. So the more interaction there is with the community, the better, and that we can choose the best way to go forward. So a central point could be a NAS server. We could use MySQL or something else. It's not 100% defined, but okay, Apache or PHP is probably very usable and will be used. We could have PostFix as a delivery point, but we had now at the moment discussions to use WebDAV, for example, and using the HTTP or maybe even the SSL link for enhanced security. Very plausible discussions. And we are really having good conversations around it. So we are starting with it. And that is very good and very challenging for everybody. So the design considerations. Okay, I mentioned a few of them, but don't take it for granted that these will be the final ones. We are still open for discussion. I won't talk too much about it. But okay, thing is, we'll use standard components, like, for example, Postfix, like Apache, PHP, MySQL, or another database. And we don't want to use a daemon. So it should be something that you push, the client push. Of course, there have to be another way. If you want to do a restore, how do you do it? Do you do it via secure shell command execution or something else? That's still not 100% defined, but okay. Okay, the web GUI interface could be, authentication could be done by LDAP. So Apache can handle that for us, Kerberos, stuff like that. This is only PHP scripts behind an Apache server, so that's not so difficult to create. But it's interesting to have a central point that you all your systems are available and listed. Okay, the real server, standard software. Okay, the roadmap, and almost this is the last slide. This is the roadmap, the 1.5, the 1.0. Hopefully will be released mid this year, so that it is as a complement for Rear, the Rear server, that we can have creating a service around disaster recovery, which is very good and very nice, and that have an extra functionality around disaster recovery. And there, of course, there are next steps, but let's go to the first step first. If you want to contact us, this is the website. We are the maintainers. Do not hesitate to subscribe yourself to the mailing list. And that was it for my talk. I'm open for questions. Please shoot.
Yes? You showed there one of the directories where all the scripts are in. So those are all shell scripts.
Bosch? Yep. The question was, can you show us a directory where all the scripts are available or stored in? On this PC I cannot show it because it's my disaster recovery PC. My PC where everything was on did not respond on the...
Is it written in Bosch?
It's all written in Bosch, yes. It's all written in shell scripts, pure simple shell scripts, and you can find everything under the /usr/share/rear subdirectory. And then you have a structure depending on the method you choose. But it is explained quite well in the concept guide, how the structure is aligned and how does it work. And of course, use the -S simulation to show which directories are in fact executed and which scripts in the directories. Yes, please?
Is this Linux only at the moment?
Yes, the question is this Linux only on this moment? Yes, it is. We are open for others, because this morning I took a CD from FreeBSD just to try it out. But okay, for the moment it's only Linux. We have Ubuntu, we have Red Hat, we have Fedora, we have all the others. Please.
Is it also copied?
Yes, the question was partition layout. Is this also copied? Yes, of course. That's the basic of disaster recovery. Everything that is important to have in a restoration of your system is copied.
You mentioned to install a new bare metal server.
The question is, if you want to do a restoration of your partitioning on another hardware,
yes.
If you have to do it manually or not, well, that is the purpose of the new release, that with the cloning P2V, that the flexibility is built in the scripting, that it will recognize other layouts. And if needed, it will propose you a question. Yes, please.
You said you don't like cloning method because when you restore your clone setup, you might have problems with the hardware. How do you solve it?
Yeah. The question was, I did not like cloning software. Well, I didn't like it for disaster recovery purposes, I meant. How do we solve it with Rear? Well, the thing is, Rear is made for disaster recovery. So we had already in the back of our minds that not all hardware that we restore in are equal. So therefore we're using, for example, UDEV to recognize different hardware systems, other types of hardware. And it will propose you a method to change, for example, an SCSI disk with a SAS disk or another type of disk. it will propose you that. That is a major step forward in the 1.9, that the cloning functionalities is more flexible. In the previous releases, it was much more strict. And then you had to do some manual tweaks. But we try to avoid it, because like we said, in a disaster environment, it has to be automatically, as much as possible. And these kind of things we can, in fact, trigger and interact with it to propose you a decent new style of underlying hardware for the network, for the storage. Yes.
Yeah. What about virtual machines and virtual servers? So you have the base system, which you have to restore first, and then to restore the various virtual disks.
Yeah.
Anything integrating that? Sure.
The question was, what about virtual systems within a basic ESX system, for example? Yeah. For the moment, if you are talking about the main system that carries the virtual systems, it will restore the main system and the backups if you want it. But it will not restore the virtual systems if they are running, because that's another kind of status. So if you want two virtual systems, you also backup or do a disaster recovery of the virtual systems. In the companies that I work, we do it like that also.
And so you basically make a bootable ISO, which then you boot within the virtual machine as the boot part of the virtual machine.
Yeah, the question was that we restore the virtual machines as with an ISO image. We restore the virtual systems, in fact, like we restore physical systems. There's no difference in the method of booting, method of restoring. Another question, yes? Yeah, I believe the question was, what about LVM in Debian?
Yeah.
Okay, Debian is on our list of supported hardware and software. So normally we have a bunch of test systems, because I know disaster recovery is a pain to test always, so we cannot test everything. But normally, by my knowledge, Debian is working quite well. And for the moment, we don't have tested everything, of course, but as far as we know, that it is working quite well with SLES, with Fedoras, Red Hats, Ubuntu, and Debians. They are on most tested environments. And there are others on the list. Other questions? Oh, that's far.
What kind of SAN components do you support?
SAN. The question was, what kind of SAN components do we support? Any kind of SAN that is your Linux is supporting. If the Linux is supporting the drivers, if you use them, they will automatically be copied to the rescue image, and they will be activated automatically. So we're using, for example, in some companies, the XP storage or EMC storage. That's quite transparent. Another question.
Does RIA need distribution-specific configuration files? Do you need, with every new distribution version, do you need to update a set of information gathering files? Or do you simply have the strategy to copy everything? Or do you need to update some configuration file for every release? And how much work?
No. The question is, for every new release, do we have to update the local configuration files of your or your site configuration files? No, not really. It's always backwards compatible. So if you do an upgrade with RPM, the local configuration file is always saved.
Does RIA need to have knowledge about the Fedora operating system? Do you have special configuration systems?
Yep. Okay.
To a new version of the release of the operating system, do you need to prepare a special release-specific version of your file?
Okay. The question was, with a new release, for example, if Fedora, does RIA also needs new versions of it? Well, to understand the new version, yes, that's true. For example, to give a very simple, this is the last question, by the way, a simple explanation on it. We have Upstart to boot your systems. We have the Sys5 init environment. And with the new Fedora, which is still not available, the 15, we will be using Systemd. Systemd is not yet supported. It's on my list for the coming weeks. But for the 1.9 release, I decided to not support it yet because I did not have the time to roll it out and to test everything again. So it was decided to make a newer version within a couple of weeks that supports the new boot environments. And we do it, in fact, for every new stuff available. A lot of patches are coming from that. Thank you for your time. Thank you for your feedback. And hopefully enjoy Relax and Recover. Thank you.